topic domain is called the modern physics, and which contains atomic physics, molecular physics, the nuclear physics, quantum mechanics, etc. Okay, that is about the two domains of physics. Okay, next about the scope and excitement of physics. Okay, scope and excitement of physics. When we consider the scope of physics, actually it is very vast. Okay, in physics actually we dealt with a variety of physical quantities. From this we can consider mass, length and time. These are the basic physical quantities in physics. Okay, and when we consider length, actually it includes what? Nuclear size. Okay, the nucleus, you know, can you imagine the size of nucleus? Actually it is very very small. It is about 10 power minus 14 meter. Okay, so actually it covers the nuclear size, that means a distance of 10 power minus 14 meter. And also when we consider the size of universe, actually it is 10 power 26 meter. Okay, so actually in physics it deals with a wider range of length. Okay, that is from 10 power minus 14 meter to 10 power 26 meter. That much wider range of distance it covers. Okay, that is the nuclear size is about 10 power minus 14 meter, and the size of the known universe is about 10 power 26 meter. Okay, also when we consider the case of mass. Okay, you know the electron is the subatomic particle. You know the mass of electron, it is around 10 power minus 30 kilogram. Okay, minus 10 power minus 30 kilogram. And when we consider the mass of entire universe, it is about to 10 power 55 kilogram. It is about to 10 power 55 kilogram. Okay, so it actually it measures this much wide range of mass, that is from 10 power minus 30 kilogram to 10 power 55 kilogram. Okay, from this that is actually it measures a tremendous range of various physical quantities such as length and mass. Okay, from this we can conclude that the scope of physics is entirely vast. Okay, and the next about what is the excitement things in physics. Okay, you know, you also excited with many things in physics. Okay, so when we talk about gravitation, you know who discovered gravitation? The great scientist Isaac Newton, who is supposed to be the father of physics. Okay, who discovered, you know the story about the discovery, behind the discovery of gravitation. Okay, and by the keen observation of Newton, by the falling of apple towards earth, actually that leads to the discovery of water, gravitation. This is quite what, exciting or interesting. Also, you know, all the objects under gravity that falls towards earth, okay, with the same acceleration, that is also quite interesting. For example, when we drop a coin or a coin and a feather at the same time or simultaneously it reaches earth. Okay, it is also quite interesting. Also when we consider when an iron nail or iron like material that attracted to its magnet, it is also quite interesting. Actually this leads to the invention of or the theory of magnetic field and electromagnetism, and leads to many other phenomena. Okay, it is also quite exciting. Also some people are exciting about what the mathematical relations in physics or mathematical equation. Some are interested in theoretical concepts, also some basic ideas or basic concepts. Okay, in this way there are many exciting things in physics. Okay, in this way there are many exciting matters in physics. Okay, next about physics technology and society. Okay, physics technology and society, actually these three are interrelated. Okay, and today's physics paves way for tomorrow's technology and day after tomorrow's boom of society. Okay, Next, that is when we consider the case of heat engine, the discovery of heat engine, actually that is the theoretical heat engine in physics, actually that led to steam engine. It had a great impact in human civilization right from the beginning of industrial revolution. Okay, the theoretical heat engine in physics that led to steam engine, which had a great impact in human civilization right from the beginning of industrial revolution, right from the beginning of industrial revolution. Okay, next, the wireless communication technology. The wireless communication technology, they led to the discovery of many laws in electricity and magnetism. Okay, the wireless communication technology, they led to the discovery of many laws in electricity and magnetism. Okay, also the study of physics of semiconductors led to the discovery of silicon chip. Okay, the study of physics of semiconductors, they led to the discovery of technology of silicon chips that triggered computer revolution. Okay, the study of physics of semiconductors led to the technology of silicon chip, actually that triggered computer revolution. Okay, at last, the development of conventional energy sources is yet another example. Okay, it's yet another example for the eagerness of human society for the energy crisis. Okay, development of conventional energy sources, yet another example for the eagerness of human society to solve energy crisis and stretching hand with the technology and society. Okay, that is about physics, technology and society. Okay, physics in relation with the other sciences. Okay, how physics is related to other branches of science. Okay, you know, physics is the most fundamental discipline of all other sciences. Okay, physics is the most fundamental discipline of all other sciences, and it has played an important role in the development of other sciences. Okay, let's see one by one how physics is related to mathematics. How physics is related to mathematics. Okay, you know, physics is a quantitative study. Okay, quantitative science. Actually, physics is a quantitative science. Okay, and mathematics provides necessary science and tools which the physicist use. Okay, mathematics provides the necessary science and tools. Okay, also it play an important role in the development of theoretical physics. Okay, mathematics play an important role in the development of theoretical physics. Okay, next, how physics is related to chemistry. Okay, actually in physics we study the structure of atom, then radioactivity and the X-ray diffraction. Okay, and all these studies that helps the chemist to arrange the elements in the periodic table according to their atomic numbers. Okay, and here the study of structure of atom, then radioactivity and diffraction studies, all these things that helps the chemist to arrange the elements in the periodic table according to their atomic numbers. Then how physics is related to biology. Okay, actually optical microscopy is used in the study of biology, and also electron microscope that is used to study the structure of cells. Okay, and also, you know, the radioisotopes that are used in the radiation therapy to cure cancer. In this way, physics is related to biology. Okay, next, physics in relation with astronomy. Okay, and then, you know, astronomical telescopes are used to study the motion of planets and also heavenly objects. Okay, astronomical telescope are used in the motion of planets and to study about the heavenly objects. Next, physics in relation with the geology. Okay, in physics we are using diffraction techniques. Actually, that techniques are used to study the crystal structure of rocks. Okay, diffraction techniques are used to study the crystal structure of rocks. Also, the technique of radioactivity that is used to know the age of rocks. Okay, the next physics in relation with the meteorology. Okay, by studying the variation of pressure with the temperature, we can forecast weather. Okay, how physics is related to meteorology. By studying the variation of temperature or pressure with the temperature, we can forecast weather. Okay, in this way, physics is related to other branches of science. Okay. Okay, next about the fundamental forces in nature. Okay, fundamental forces in nature. We all have the idea that a force is needed to push, pull, throw, or break, or deform, or even to change the motion of object. Okay, that already we learned in lower classes about the force. Okay, and here the pulling force is called tension, and the pushing force is called compression. Okay, the pulling force is called tension, and the pushing force is called compression. Okay, in our everyday life, we come across different types of forces. Okay, can you say what are the different types of forces in nature? Okay, you know, force of gravity, then force of buoyancy, then electrostatic force, magnetic force, then elastic force, then contact force, you know, different types of forces. Okay, actually all these forces are arise from four basic forces in nature. Okay, all these forces arise from the four basic forces in nature. What are the four what are the four fundamental forces in nature? The first is the gravitational force. The gravitational force, and second is the electromagnetic force. And the third is the strong nuclear force. And fourth is the weak nuclear force. Okay, these are the four fundamental forces in nature. Gravitational force, electromagnetic force, then strong nuclear force, and weak nuclear force. Okay, let's see one by one. First is the gravitational force. Okay, actually you learned about the gravitational forces in 9th standard. Okay, actually this force exists between two objects by virtue of their masses. Actually, the gravitational force exists between two objects by virtue of their masses. Okay, actually this is a universal force. Gravitational force can be considered as a universal force because in the universe, in between every object, this force exists. Okay, that is why it is called a universal force. Actually, this force arises by virtue of the masses of the objects. Okay, actually, this quantitative nature of this gravitational force is governed by Newtonian law. Okay, that is we can explain the gravitational force with the help of Newton's law of gravitation. Okay, Newton's law of gravitation. Okay, here we have two objects having masses m1 and m2. Okay, then we can represent the distance between the two objects as is r. Then according to Newton's law of gravitation, a force is exist between any two objects. Okay, and that is here we have two objects having masses m1 and m2. They are separated by a distance r. So there is a force of attraction between these two objects, and that force is directly proportional to the product of their masses, that is m1 and m2. F proportional m1 and m2, and it is inversely proportional to square of distance between the two objects. Okay, according to Newton's law of gravitation, the force of attraction between two objects is directly proportional to the product of their masses and inversely proportional to the square of distance between the two objects. Okay, then we can combine these two equations as F is equal to G into M1 M2 divided by R square. Okay, and this is the mathematical relation for universal law of gravitation. You know, where G is the universal force constant. Okay, universal gravitational constant, where capital G represents the universal gravitation constant. Okay, that is the according to universal law of gravitation, the force between two objects can be represented in the form F is equal to G M1 M2 divided by R square, where G stands for universal gravitation constant, where M1 and M2 represent the masses of the two objects, and R that represent the distance between the two objects. Okay. That is about the gravitational force. Then what are the important properties of this gravitational force? Actually, it is a long range force. So it is a long range force, and it is always attractive in nature. Okay, the gravitational force is always attractive. And it is a central force. That is, it always acts along the line joining the centers of the two objects. That is why it is called a central force. And also, it is the weakest force. Okay, among the four forces known, the gravitational force is the weakest force in nature. Okay, then what are the properties of this gravitational force? It is a long range force. It is always attractive. Then it is a central force. Then it is the weakest force in nature. And also it does not depend upon the medium. Okay, These are the important properties of the force, gravitational force. Okay. Okay, next about the electromagnetic force. The second force is the electromagnetic force. Actually, it consists of, this electromagnetic force consists of electrostatic force and magnetic force. Okay, Okay, suppose if we are considering two static charges, that means the charges at rest. Okay, suppose if you are considering two charges, Q1 and Q2. In between these two charges, this electrostatic force exists. Okay, in between the two charges, the electrostatic forces exist. And this electrostatic force is attractive or repulsive depends upon the charge it possesses. Okay, the electrostatic force is attractive or repulsive. You know, like charges repel each other, and unlike charges attract each other. That is, among, in between the like charges, there is force of repulsion, and in between the unlike charges, there is force of attraction. Okay, that is about the electrostatic force. Next come to magnetic force. Actually, magnetic force exists between magnetic poles. Okay, magnetic force that exists between magnetic poles. Okay, I think you have already learned about the magnetic poles in 10th standard. We have two poles, North Pole and South Pole. Okay, in the case of poles, here also we have two North Poles there and two South Poles there. Okay, and these are the like poles. In between these like poles, there is the repulsive force, and in between the unlike poles, there is the attractive force. That means like poles repel each other, and unlike poles attract each other. Okay, and here we already learned around a stationary charge there exists electrostatic force. Okay, there is electrostatic force, and when the charge is in motion, then comes the magnetic force. Okay, that is, around a stationary charge, an electric field is created. Okay, and this electric field can exert what? Electrostatic force. And when the electric charge is in motion, there is a magnetic field is produced. And this magnetic field can exert what? Magnetic force. So these two are interrelated. This electric force and magnetic force are interrelated, and so we can name it as electromagnetic force. Okay, we can name it as electromagnetic force. And this electromagnetic force is 10^36 times greater than this gravitational force. Okay, this electromagnetic force is 10^36 times greater than the gravitational force. Okay, and this then what are the properties of this electromagnetic force? Actually, it is attractive or repulsive. Okay, this electromagnetic force is attractive or repulsive. Then actually, it also does not depends upon the medium. Like gravitational force, this electromagnetic force does not depends upon the intervening medium. Then it is also a long range force. Electromagnetic force can be considered as a long range force, and it is also a central force. Okay, it is also a central force, and both gravitational and electromagnetic force that obeys inverse square law. Okay, both obeys inverse square law. Both electromagnetic force and gravitational force obeys inverse square law. Okay, these are the properties of electromagnetic force. Okay, the next comes strong nuclear force. Next come the strong nuclear force. I think you are familiar with the nucleus. Okay, you are familiar with the central part of an atom. Actually, it is the nucleus. Then what are the constituent particles are inside the nucleus? You know. Okay, it is the proton and neutrons. Protons and neutrons are inside the nucleus. You know, and the electrons are revolving around the nucleus in specified orbits. Okay, the electrons are revolving around the nucleus in specified orbits. Then what is the strong nuclear force actually? It is that force that binds the nucleons together inside the nucleus. Here the protons and neutrons are together called the nucleons. Protons and neutrons are together called the nucleons, and this strong nuclear force that binds the nucleons inside the nucleus. Okay, actually it acts between proton and proton, also it can act between proton and neutron, and also it is between proton and neutron. So actually it is a charge independent force. Okay, the nuclear force, that is a charge independent force. Actually it does not depends on the charge. Okay, does not depends on the charge, and also actually this force exists within the nucleus itself. So it is a short range force. It is a short range force. Okay, then what are the properties of this strong nuclear force? Actually it is a charge independent force. It is a short range force, and it is the strongest force in nature. Okay, strong nuclear force is the strongest force in nature. Okay, it is the strongest force in nature. Actually it is 100 times greater than this magnitude of this electromagnetic force. Okay, the strong nuclear force is as much stronger, 100 times stronger than this electromagnetic force. Okay, then what are the properties of this strong nuclear force? It is a short range force. Actually it is a charge independent force. It is the strongest force in nature. Okay, actually this force exists in between the nucleons. Okay, actually this force is required to bind the nucleons together inside the nucleus. Okay, that is about the strong nuclear force. And next come weak nuclear force. Okay, actually this force is also act within the nucleus. Okay, actually this force come into play where the nuclear process takes place, that is radioactivity, that we'll study detail in plus 2 class. Okay, radioactivity, and this weak nuclear force that comes into play only when the nuclear process like radioactivity will takes place. Okay, and this force is also a short range force. This also does not depend upon the charge. Okay, and this force is actually weaker than this strong nuclear force, but it is stronger than this gravitational force. Okay, this weak nuclear force is stronger than this gravitational force. Okay, that is about the four fundamental forces in nature. That is gravitational force, then electromagnetic force, strong nuclear force, and weak nuclear force. Okay. Okay, children, study well. That is the end of today's class. Thank you.